The reducing the strength campaign has carried on going from strength to strength. And the good news to report about that was a couple of weeks ago, the last remaining store selling super strength cider and lager in Birkenhead, which is in the Cumulative Impact Policy area, has signed up to Skin, which is being in. And they've also volunteered to sign up their list by the Wallasey store too. So we have no super strength cider and lager. That obviously doesn't stop people drinking half of it, but they're drinking less half of it than they were before.
Thanks very much. Yes, thank you.
Very quickly, comment on that. On the alcohol strength, alcohol licensing committee, we make representation, we scrutinise our licensing when applications come in for smaller off licensing. What about the large chains, the Tesco's, and I mean, Lidl's in the cumulative impact area, just as an illustration. We're looking seriously at the small outlets all around Oxford Road and Charing Cross. But Lidl's come along, opened a store, which is good, but they're selling alcohol so cheap. But they're licensed, they don't have to come before our committee.
They do have a type of license.
But yes, they do, but they don't come before the committee. Are we making representation? My question really is, are we making representation to the larger outlets? It's still possible to drink yourself to death.
Yes, we are approaching the larger outlets, but all of the larger supermarket chains, they're not officially signed up for reducing the strength scheme, but I don't think they'd like to put themselves forward to that by name, but they comply with the requirements of that scheme anyway. So they don't sell these particular products that we've been looking to get them to take off the shelf. The only ones that did were Iceland and B&M, and they've both withdrawn those products now. So Lidl won't be selling 7.5% lager of cider, nor the Tesco, nor the Sainsbury's.
Yeah, do you want to make a quick point?
I'm also on the licensing authority with Councillor Sullivan, and I have to say, you brought up a very valid point. We've been extremely supportive, particularly of Councillor Statement, and we've clearly brought this to the table about major problems in her ward, and I do genuinely sympathise with her. I think my concern, and it's probably shared by Mike, is that we spend our time looking at the small retail and we make necessary adjustments to whether they can or can't sell, and then suddenly somebody comes along, whether that be Asda or Lidl, and literally blows it out of the water, and it makes something of a bit of a joke really, the licensing panel. In the sense that we're actually penalising the small guy, and yet the big guy, Lidl being a perfect example, just comes along and just walks in. So I have to say I have some grave concerns that we as a council are being made a little bit silly here.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks,
Adrian. Thanks, Gary. Next item on the agenda is the annual report.
Thank you very much. I will be quick. It is a report that we're required to make under statute to report on our complex performance to members. The report which you've seen highlights a number of issues. Just briefly, we have seen a fall in the number of complaints we've received over the past year. Partially that's due to improvements we made in certain areas such as the building for domiciliary care, but also more complaints going direct to the providers themselves. In terms of us responding to the complaints, our timescales for responding to complaints are higher than perhaps they are in other areas of the council, but I think that at least in partially is due to the quality of the responses and the investigations that we do into the matters and the complex areas. That's borne out by the Ombudsman responses, the Ombudsman investigations into our area, where in the vast majority of cases they're not requiring us to take any other action, any other rectification than we've already taken and identified within the department. Finally, what I'll just mention is in terms of the complaints that we are made direct to providers of services, to commission services. We are gathering increasingly information direct from the providers of the nature of the complaints they're receiving, That's reflected upon in the report. The information we receive around those complaints is analysed and feeds into the quality assurance process, the contract monitoring team, etc. And into projects they've done, for instance, on medication. We are tightening up further on that system and introducing a separate element to the computer system that will require providers to report and prompt them to report the complaints we're receiving on a monthly basis, so we'll get a regular update in terms of the issues that are arising, which will help us keep a close eye on that. And I'll leave it there unless there's any other questions.
The only thing I'd like to note, by committee's note, is that response times have deteriorated quite significantly. Can you give us an explanation for that?
Yes, I think, I mean, partly, as I said, our response times are generally higher than the other parts of the council. But I think also this year, as you'll be aware, the department has gone through quite a period of transition. With a large element of the operational service going through a process of transfer into the NHS. And I think that's meant that the complaints team has taken on a much more proactive role in terms of dealing with complaints rather than the operational managers. And that has had an impact upon the timescales for complaints.
Christina, yeah, it's just on page 16 on the outcomes. When it says premature, does that mean they've gone to the ombudsman before the process has been got through?
Yes.
Okay. Anybody else want to make a comment? Just for noting, so I'll ask if you know that. Okay, thank you. The next item on the agenda is priorities and plan for use of the better care fund. Can I ask again that Sarah has found this report rather than put it in the sun, but
thank you, Chair. I mean, I'll be very brief. When people got the report, I'll be happy to take questions at the end. I just propose to pull out a few overarching key messages. You'll be aware this is an integrated commission and submission by the CCG and the Rural Council, which has been developed and agreed with all providers across the health and social care system. BCF is clearly focusing on driving forward integration and helping deliver a sustainable 7-day service across health and social care. This is supported in healthy rural priorities and commissioning plans across health and social care, so it is fully connected with all our priorities across the organisation. This is our third BCF submission, should be aware that it's nationally mandated. This one is unusual. This is the first 2-year submission that we have been requested to submit. We are extremely late in the year, as I'm sure you're aware. Usually we do submit to start in line with financial years, but there has been a whole host of reasons why the guidance was delayed. It was due out in December. We actually didn't get the guidance until the summer. So the deadline for submission, it was the first and final submission this year, which has been different. Timescales were very quick when we got the guidance. So submission went in this Monday on the 11th to NHS England. I will come on at it just in a moment to just tell you what the next steps are. Very quickly, we are requesting, they have tried to streamline what the focus of the BCF is in terms of key performance priorities. The 4 key areas that we are expected to focus on, like all areas, all systems, are continuing a 3.5% annual reduction on non-elective admissions. The second one is continuing to reduce admissions to long-stay residential and nursing care. Third one is around effectiveness of our enablement services. And the fourth one, which is a new one, is around a nationally agreed reduction to a maximum of 3.5%. What is people access, delayed transfers of care, so people in an acute setting who are medically optimised and able to be discharged to appropriate services or for assessment if they were available. Those have had to be nationally agreed with NHS England, and we've spent a long time across the system working through checking those trajectories and what our plans would need to look like to achieve those. very quickly, the previous expectations around the things you'll be very familiar with around a 7-day community offer, joint assessment, care planning, systems connecting, talking to each other, all those sorts of things will stand. So we still expect you to continue to deliver against those principles. The key changes this year are that we are very much building on the national best practice evidence around reducing the length of stay for people who have to be admitted to hospital, actually reducing those length of stays. What we know, and I know we've had conversational agreements around this, so I won't go into lots of detail. What we do know is that for people over the age of 85, for every 10 days in bed, acute or community, that's equivalent to 10 years of ageing, and that deconditioning people actually never recover from. And through other conversations this afternoon, this evening, people have alluded to the challenges we have in the market around things like domiciliary care, complexity of need, acuity, and clearly we're not helping that situation for people if people are in hospital beds, awaiting interventions, awaiting packages, or awaiting whatever. So our focus is absolutely to minimise the stay in acute setting, to make sure that we have adequate community provision, either bed-based or at the person's own home, to assess the ongoing need at a properly acute setting. So we've invested heavily in those facilities outside hospital. Just to finally add there, the other areas that we've invested in have been around additional dementia nurses to support assessment and ongoing support in the community. We know the challenge we have around people growing demand for dementia. Increased investment in things like teletriage, because we know we have to start to invest in more innovative services. We need to release our professional workforce to target where we need to look at ways that actually will support the workforce to do more for less. So teletriage is really quite exciting. We're investing increasingly in those areas. Increasing support to care home and also things like the third sector. We're having a growing role to support discharge lounge, the single gateway, and actually helping people with home of choice so people can be independently supported, you know, without paying professional time and so on. And the last couple of areas are we have put additional investment into domiciliary care. We know about the challenges there at the moment. Models like Trusted Assessor, where we are agreeing with our providers and our providers are trained to assess within parameters on our behalf and actually help that flow and respond appropriately to individuals. Public health, we have had added in their drug and alcohol services, which is a real positive move forward. And we have finally had a much more robust winter plan and contingency fund in the Medicare fund. So we have a much more measured and planned approach to winter, and not only the winter challenges, but also the pressures and acuity pressures that we're facing. Very quick summary then on the funding allocation. This year it's 44.8 million, year two, 52.2 million. For those of you who want to know, this is split up into two elements. We've got the core BCF, and then we've got what we've now termed the improved Medicare fund. The improved Medicare fund is 8.3 million. That is split, and some of this is mandatory, into 5 million protection of social care, which is mandated. We do have 1.3 million for supporting capacity to support transfers from hospital and reduce the delay in discharges. And 2 million has been agreed as a local system to badges innovation, and that is giving us the chance to actually start to invest in some things I've mentioned around teletriage and so on, to test those, evaluate them, and then make them call if they can prove concept for year two. The next steps are that we receive feedback from NHSE for whether we're approved or approved with conditions at the end of September, early October. We are going to Health and Wellbeing Board. They had an update a few weeks ago for final approval, so we've had to submit pending formal approval from Health and Wellbeing Board, although all partners are cited on this and have been fully engaged. And our deadline for local budget submission, again, which will go to Health and Wellbeing Board for sign off, is November, and that's in line with the national requirements for time scales.
Okay. Questions? The report has been noting. Thank you very much for that. We're happy to note that. Item 900.
This is an actual monthly report, the usual report that comes to the committee. Is this a new format this time? Yeah. In that the information that is contained is solely to adult social care and public health. Overall, the reports indicated that with the additional contingency of £2 million allocated, the annual social care budget will meet its projected level of spending, and there was a small unspent within the public health budget in relation to staff vacancies, but going forward, the level will need to be reviewed as opposed to filling. I think it might be useful just to spend a couple of minutes just to illustrate in a little bit more detail, given the report is so summarised, the makeup of the budget, something like budget pressures and the budget savings. I've tried there to summarise both the adult social care budget and the public health budget. £77.5 million is the total net budget, but what you can see straight away is the spending power that there is in those two areas is more than double that of £70 million. Looking at the makeup of the budget, the reason it's so much higher is of course you've got the significant amounts of grant that's within those budgets, and also a level of £20 million which is related to service user charges. In terms of adult social care, you've got a budget of £10 million for employees. £10 million for employees. And care packages, which is the most significant part of the budget, just over half of that £200 million is spent on older people packages, and just under half is spent on learning disability and mental health. Within public health, the vast majority of the budget, the £13 million budget, is commissioned on areas that, such as smoking cessation, alcohol, drugs abuse, not 19 children's programme. In terms of the budget, the key pressures of our budget are all to do with the lines the care package to the next slide. You can see there that we're talking this year in terms of the budget, around about £20 million we're looking at pressures on the budget. The left hand column illustrates some of the reasons why the budget is coming under pressure. So the top line there are the increases in fee rates. Fee rates resulting both from attempts to stabilise the market, which I think is fairly well documented nationally, but also as a result of the national minimum wage. So minimum wage increasing from £7.20 to £7.50 this year adds around about 4% to the overall rate of fees. Demographic growth reflects increases in the care population both in terms of older people, around about 1.7% this year, and also in learning disability. We estimate around about a 5% increase in the numbers of young people requiring support. That's a care fund, £3.3 million. That reflects some of what Jackie was talking about before, about the innovation fund and about the £1.3 million for delayed discharge. Learning disabilities and mental health cost reduction targets of £1 million. This is part of a 4-year programme to reduce LD and mental health costs. Prior pressures are, as they say, cost pressures brought forward from previous years, and the one-off costs are costs whereby additional funding was provided last year has been repaid out of this year's budget. So around about £20 million, the right-hand side of the spreadsheet shows how this has been funded. Around about £15 million from additional grant funding, so additional BCF, social care precept, and other social care grants. And around about £5.4 million from additional £2 million contingency, and denied management. So clearly that latter part is the means by which budgets will be balanced this year in being able to contain the demand pressures. That there is a summary of the savings targets that they referred to in the report, where it says that they're all green and blue. So I'm not going to go through that list because they're pretty much the same list as reflects in the budget pressures. The one thing I would say, I suppose, it might strike a bit unusual why you're showing cost pressures as savings. And what that really reflects is that those are the cost pressures that are being met within the existing resources of the budget. Okay, moving on. There's a section in the book that talks about debt and the level of outstanding debt within social care. £15 million is by far the largest part of the council's debts and arrears, around about £24 million. As it says there, there are around about 7,100 people owning the seat of social care, and just over 80% of those are contributing something towards the cost of their care. About half of that debt is in respect of residential care, and the remainder is covering care costs of care packages and dual-funded placements with CCG. Within the £15 million, there's just short of £2 million, which is deferred income, being money that is deferred for a period of time linked to the assets of the people receiving care. And clearly, the requirements there that there continues to be recovery on student debt and elements of debt which are related to the final section of the report that talks about capital programme and the particular schemes, the risk-based schemes, of around about £14. Chair, I'll pause there and I'm happy to circulate the slides if that's useful to members. And my colleague Matt Goss is happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Are there any questions for members? I think it would be a good idea to segregate the slides. Yeah, thank you.
Just quickly, 4.3 million is the correction of the government team. How much of that would you predict is actually changed from 2014 to 2030? You said it was in the legal processes. Am I understanding right that is money owed to the council?
It is, yes.
Yes. So, what was the expectation of being successful in the recovery? What percentage would you expect to recover?
It's a very difficult question to answer. I mean, clearly, as the debt ages, then it is more difficult to collect. But there is an element within that aged debt that relates to deferred debt, and that should be possible to collect.
Just important to state on the deferred debt scenario, everyone now has the right to defer the payments against the value of their property or other assets that they have. So important interest to make because it does mean that we will grow exponentially in coming years. But obviously it's a good thing because it enables people to have more choice. Something. It would be helpful for us to have some schematic that will show us
how that works in practice.
We do have that without too much difficulty, and think that would, it's only that would be sent out in the financial system.
That's a second point. It's all capital. Many times I've asked about extra-care housing in various places, but we know from reports to committee previously that changes in the rules about benefits and so on have really hit the development of that sector. I think it was somewhere where we were told that we were studying an example from Nosley where they might have worked out how to do it, as by Stephen's explanation. But some councils appear to be finding ways of developing the kind of mental cause, and the housing 21 scheme in Wallasey, there are some of the schools
on the rock very high side.
Some of them have cracked it, and we still not have cracked it, because it still seems to also have cracked it, they're ready to go when we've cracked it.
So, well, the good news is things are starting to move. So, the housing providers that we looked at to move the extra care over last year to join the big consultation on the grant dollars with the government are now starting to move. So, big providers like Magenta and others are now starting to move. So, we've had problems for at least 12 months in that area. We have been able to move one or two small schemes forward with what we call venture capitalist type organisations. Some of that has been successful, some of it's run into problems when we've got into the kind of legals around how the money moves around and all of those sorts of things. So I think now that the social housing providers are starting to feel much more confident about the market, we'll see that some of that will be moving.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I just say Andrew, thank you very much for that presentation.
Yes, sure.
And we could understand it, was really good. Okay, thanks, Gerard. You're free to go, thank you. Item 10 on the agenda is the Wirral plan of performance. And this, you don't want to. I think there's two things I want to say. There is, I want to highlight, which you may have noticed to answer. One is on the figures around domestic violence, which appear to be deteriorating, particularly reporting. The newly established family safety unit, because anybody could give us some information about that. But there's two other points I want to make. One is that it's good to see information on how we're achieving on the Wirral plan, but there is information that probably is relevant to this committee that is not contained in this. And we always have the feeling that we're missing something, that there's something going on that we're not quite getting to. And my suggestion, and I'm sure Julie will agree with this, which comes back. For her to initiate it, is that we have a meeting again with the people who put together the data that we look at and the spokespersons and myself to try and get that the right information coming to us to reassure us that things are being done in the way that they should across the board. And the other thing I'd like to say is we had a mechanism in the old system, in the old committee, where every 6 weeks we met and we looked at health and care performance. Specifically at that and other issues around delivery of service. And it was a panel part of the subcommittee, but it was very, very useful for scrutinising health performance. And we have got a mechanism for that in this setup, and we need to allow the mechanism to do that. That's something that's a piece of work that we need to do quite quickly, I would think. Okay?
Can I just thought we need to do that, and I'm surprised we haven't put it in place because the performance. The detailed performance, the adult social care outcomes framework, what's happening around urgent care, all of those things are equally as important as the
other.
So I will take a look at the
head of intelligence.
Thank you.
Okay, item, are we ready to move on?
Yeah.
Item 11 on the agenda, and I'll be very brief on this because this is feedback from a workshop that we had. It was a joint workshop between the Children's Committee and this committee, and it was to look in some detail at the All Age Disability and Mental Health Transformation Programme. It was very, very quite detailed. Thank the officers who delivered that. I don't propose, I don't think you do either, to go through what was discussed. Members had plenty of opportunity to look in detail and discuss. And I think the report that you have here is going to be attached to the cabinet report when it goes to cabinet in October. That's
does anybody want to make a comment? I would say I don't feel we need to because we were fully involved in both in the project. Okay, we're happy to know this and let's go to the next. Item 12 is the policy of four documents, which is standard and is really denoting. If anybody wants to comment on it or ask a question, please don't ask a question. That's nobody can answer. And item 13 is the work programme. We're still busy, isn't it, Christine? The Respite Services Scrutiny Review, which was going really well, we put on hold pending the visit to High Rush Road so that we could hear from people who don't have the experience of using it. I understand that we're ready to go on and now get that news off the ground and we'll have the first cycle of the respite offer and receive from that. So we will be doing that. The Continuing Health Care Funding Scrutiny, which is chaired by we had a meeting on the other day, and it's last week, I think. And what we had there was rather a different story than we had from the CCG providers. So it's interesting to see the difference between the application of this new framework and how it's working. But at the end of it, we'll produce a report which will have some recommendations for me to talk to. I've spoken about the All Age Mental Health Transformation Project. We've got spotlight sessions planned. I don't think we've got the date we might have there, Alan, have we? Spotlight session, structure on the NHS, which I think, Simon, you're going to do.
12th of October, Chair.
Hey?
12th of October, Chair.
Thank you. And another spotlight session, looking at specialist transport, because that was a budget issue last year, the year before. But what came, what emerged from our scrutiny of that plan was that really very much detail of how alternative provision would take place. I mean, we wanted to see a lot more detail, and though this spotlight session better picture as they've developed. Yes?
Obviously not discussing it too widely. Are you aware of the complaints that were voiced by licensing panel with regards to some of the issues?
No, we are there for the
Just are you aware of that? It probably needs to be fed in, I think.
Okay, well, the spotlight session will be a good opportunity to do that.
Okay. General matter, it does fit in with the arrangements in the paper. Several occasions this evening, we have discussed the protocol for the health service telling us about what is going to change. I sort of searched around but not found any original version of that. So if prior to the moment we could have that circulated to us so we know what the document is in place of thought, we would certainly inform us when it comes to talk about the matters on page 19 related to SDP at the later stage.
Yeah. Say it again,
one more.